Good afternoon, everybody. For the post-lunch session, we have Tamil cultural scenes, dynamics, developments, and future. Jataayu will chair this session.
I request the panelists to come and take their seats. Dr. Nagaswamy, maybe. Ganesh, Lakshminarayanan. Maybe he can sit here. No? Is this a better position? And Nagarajan, sir. Namaskar and Vanakkam, everyone, for this afternoon session in the day one of Republic Point Elite Fest. So, the panel is titled Tamil Cultural Scenes, Dynamics, Developments and Future. As we know, all know, Tamil culture is nothing but the sweetest fruit of the Indian or Bharatiya culture. It is part and parcel of the Indic cultural matrix. So it is to explore this theme that's the aim of this panel. The moment we say Tamil culture, we all remember this evocative poem of Subramanya Bharati. Most of the Tamils know it. Sendamil nadenum podinile, inbathen vandu payudu kaadinile. He says, the moment I say Tamil Nadu, the honey of bliss flows in my ears. And then he says, Yengal Tandayar Nadendra Pechinile, or Shakti Pirakkudu Moochinile. When we say this is the land of our ancestors, even our breathing becomes powerful. And then he lists down aspects of Tamil culture so beautifully. You know, it's such a precise definition of what makes Tamil culture. So that's why this poem is most important. So he starts off saying, Vedam Nirainda Tamil Nadu, Uyar Viram Serinda Tamil Nadu. He says, Tamil Nadu is the land filled with Veda. And then Viram, that is valor. Then he goes on and lists the rivers of Tamil Nadu. Kaviri Tenpennai Palaru, Tamil Kandador Vayai Porunai Nadi, Yena Meviya Aru Palavoda, Thirumeni Sezhitha Tamil Nadu. Says, there is Kaveri, Vaigai, Pennai, Tamraparni, these great rivers that makes Tamil Nadu a sacred geography, right? Not just the rivers, hills, forests, temples. So this is another second aspect of Tamil culture, that it's a sacred and divine geography. And then he goes on and says, Kalvi Siranda Tamil Nadu, Pugal Kamban Piranda Tamil Nadu. He talks about learning, education and knowledge. So Tamil Nadu has been a seat of learning from time immemorial. Some of the great savants and sages have come from this land. And he lists the three great icons of Tamil literature, Kamban, Valluvan, and Ilango. And then he says, Singalam Pushpagam Savagam Agiya Thivu Palavinum Sendreri. He says, the islands of Simhala, the islands of Java, Champa, in all these islands, the Tamils unfurled their flags. So that shows, that is another aspect of Tamil culture, which is the enterprising and the merchandise spirit. So this is another aspect of Tamil culture. And then he goes on to say, Nal Kalai Jnanam Valartha Tamil Nadu. The arts, the knowledge, the various fine art forms like Carnatic music, Bharatanatyam, or even, you know, the Tamil Nadu is a place with a vibrant film industry. So these are, again, aspects of Tamil culture. So such a rich, vibrant culture and its many aspects is what is going to be the theme of this panel. So before we head to it, there's going to be honoring of Padma Bhushan Dr. or Nagaswamy. He needs no introduction as to many of us. You know, at 90 years of age, he is the Bhishma Pitamaha of Tamil cultural studies, history and archaeology. A highly renowned historian, archaeologist, epigraphist. He was the founder director of Tamil Nadu Archaeology Department and served as its director for 20 years. The golden period of archaeology in Tamil Nadu. So prior to that, he was the curator of Government Museum in Chennai, one of the best museums in the country. And he is also an erudite scholar in two of the most ancient languages of India, Tamil and Sanskrit. So from his first book about the art and culture of Tamil Nadu in the 1980s, till his recent book, which came out last year on Thirukkural, he has been a prolific author of many books, and he has created awareness about archaeology, history, and culture all over Tamil Nadu by many of his initiatives, including, you know, some of the things which are like ubiquitous. So you go to ASI site and you see the pocket books about, you know, whether it is Konark or Hampi. So he was the person who initiated this practice in Tamil Nadu of writing nicely illustrated pocket books about the historical monuments. And the famous London Nataraja case in the 1980s, where a Nataraja icon was stolen from a village in Tamil Nadu and found its way to the London, and we had to fight it and bring it back. And Dr. Nagaswamy heroically represented the Indian side in that case, and he won acclaim from the British legal luminaries and officials for the way he presented the case and argued. So such is the greatness of Dr. Nagaswamy. So now I request the organizers of PLF to come and present the citation in his honor. I'll read out the words in the citation. These are the words in the citation. Not result is the purpose of action, but God's eternal delights, seeing and doing. Sri Aurobindo. Republic Pondi Litfest 2009 is honored to pay its respects to Padma Vibhushan Dr. Nagaswamy for his lifetime contribution in the domains of archaeology, epigraphy, classical literature and architecture of Tamil Nadu. He has been the bearer of the light of truth and dharma, continuing the ever-living tradition of great Tamil scholars from time immemorial to this day. Now I request Dr. Nagaswamy to give his presentation and enlighten us.
Friends, I am thankful to the organizers for giving me this opportunity to participate in this great festival. I thought I should start with a question whether we could call this what is called Tamil culture or culture in Tamil Nadu. I think they have two different meanings, no? So, I think I prefer the second one. Culture in Tamil Nadu, not Tamil culture. We have no separate Tamil culture. There is only one culture in the whole country. And so, Subramanya Bharati, he mentioned, has given one beautiful sentence. My mother, India, speaks in 18 different languages, but her thought is only one. Seppum moli padinettudayal. Enil chintanai ondrudayal. So that sums up that there are several languages here in this country, but their culture is only one. That's how she thinks. And so I giving you some ideas about different aspects. Mainly, I'll focus on four important points. And I hope I'll be able to finish within the time allotted, and I will not exceed the time, because then it becomes apatal. So, kindly guide me to stop at the correct time. What is a nation? Nation represents a well-defined space and demarcated by boundaries, inhabited by people who follow uniform lifestyle and customs and emotionally attached to that country as their own. Next one, please. Bharata, remind one. In the light, can somebody put this off? One nation from time immemorial. It was well defined as a space extending from Kashmir to Kanyakumari and from Afghanistan to Assam in the east throughout the centuries for the past 3,000 to 4,000 years. Next please. The life of the people of this country was inspired by and controlled by the Vedas, which are called Shrutis. The earliest constitution of India, based on the teachings of the Vedas, was compiled by Vaivaswata Manu, who might have lived earlier than 500 BC, which is called Dharma Shastra. The Indian society was controlled by two systems, also called the path of life as Pravritti Marga and Nivritti Marga, meaning worldly life and religious life. The Dharma Shastras, can you go back please, 1 minute, fall under the guidelines of the worldly life, that is Pravritti Marga, or what we can call worldly life. So the idea that there is a separate religious life and there is a worldly life was already there in the ancient system. There are some fundamental concepts followed throughout India, irrespective of region or language. The human life was not considered a vague and aimless living, but well-defined roots called Dharma, Artha, Kama, and Moksha, called Purusharthas. Studentship, married life, penance, and recluse, or the other four ashramas, these are called ashramas, as Brahmachari, Grahastha, Vanaprastha, and Sannyasi. These are called the ashramas, four ashramas. Then we have Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and Sudra, and other mixed castes. It was never only four, but they also had the mixed castes. And called Varna. So this is what we call Varnashrama Dharma. These were the fundamental concepts known throughout India, including in Tamil Nadu, from earliest times. Next one, please. Manu classified the Indian nation as Brahma Varta, Brahma Rishi Desa, Madhya Desa, Arya Varta, and Yajna Bhumi. These are the five. These divisions are not based on language. So at the time of Manu, there was no linguistic division of this country. It was only the space, more sensibly. And rulership, but based on natural geographical boundaries like rivers and hills. Quite beautiful, no? Brahma Artha consists of the region between the river Saraswati and Drishadvati rivers, which are called divine rivers, Deva Nadis. And they were dried up at the time of division itself. The second one consisted of Kurukshetra, Panchala, Surasena, and Kanyagupta. These are called Brahma Rishi Desa. Next. The third one is called Madhya Desa, from Himalayas in the north and Vindhya Mountain in the south, Saraswati in the west, and Prayaga in the east, from where one can see the rising sun. These are what is mentioned in Manu's Shastra. Whatever I say, these are there in Manu's work. The fourth one is south of the Vindhyas and bounded by the eastern ocean and western ocean, called the Aryavarta. The fifth is the region south up to Kanyakumari, where the black buck deer moves freely without fear, where the Brahmanas perform yajnas. This part, please. This I want you to keep it in mind, because there is a specific reason why I want you to remember this. That is, the black buck deer moves freely without fear where the Brahmanas perform yajnas, pujas. Next. You can see, you know, a whole country which is now further truncated, but originally it was Saraswati, and then Brahma Rishi Desa, and Madhya Desa, and Aryavarta. And the bottom most one is the Yajna Bhumi. So Tamil Nadu, Andhra, Karnataka, and Kerala would fall under Yajna Bhumi, where at the time of Manu, the whole thing was called Yajna Bhumi, including Tamil Nadu. So there was no such a thing as anything different from the All India concept. Next. Many ancient Tamil poems assignable to 1st, 2nd century CE refer to Imayam. Imayam is the Tamil form, or you can say Prakrit form, of Himalayas. Himalayas. Imayam to Kumari in Tamil Nadu. So the earliest Tamil literature available, which can be taken back to 1st, 2nd century AD, has many, many references to one country, Himalayas to Kumari. Imayam to Kumari. And in some places it is called ice, mountain of ice to Kumari. Pani Padu, cold peaks of Himalayas to Kumari. Several types of references are there in earliest Tamil literature. And so, from the known history of India, the known history of Tamil Nadu, there was only one country which they again and again referred to as Imayam to Kumari. This is very important in modern context. Interestingly, early Tamil Sangam works assignable to the 2nd century frequently refer to the Himalayas and Padigai Mountain. Padigai Mountain is very near Kumari, Kanyakumari. And that is where Sage Agastya is said to have come and stayed there when he came from northern part of India, bringing with him the kings and chieftains, and there he stayed. And all subsequent literature referred to Agastya as the father of Tamil language. Next. Now, I am going to show you a very interesting art representation, extraordinary art representation, and let us see what it is. Next. Is it visible or very, very pale? You know, you see a deer lying down with its leg and touching the nose, you know, just like this. And then at the back, you have its consort. So both male and female deers are there. Represented it one of the greatest sculpture of the world at Mahabalipuram, 700 AD, where you see the whole Ganga coming down from the outer space down to Himalayas, and from Himalayas it comes down and comes to the ground and then goes to the nether world. And there this representation is found, and this has a specific meaning. Next. Now this is one of the very early Tamil poems which says, Siru Thalai Navvi, the little face of the deer, it touches like this, Navvi Perum Kan Maapinai. They appear as pinai, male and female together, maapinai, andi andanar arum kadan irikkum. In the evening, in the dawn, you know, sandhi. Sandhi is morning, midday and evening. And andanar arum kadan irikkum. They perform the Vedic prayers. Kadan irukum rituals. Mutti vilakir tunjum perkottu imayamum podiyilum pondre. The golden peak of the Himalayas, in between golden peak of Himalayas and the Podiyal hills. Podiyal hills is near Kumari. So, according to this, which is about 1st, 2nd century AD, this poem, there is a description. The description says, where the black buck freely moves and sits down in the place of the Brahminas performing rituals, Vedic ritual. And but what is interesting is that Siru Thalai Navvi, this poet, repeats what is mentioned in Manu's Dharma Shastra. Exactly the same reference is given. Next. The poem is sung by one of the early Tamil poets and an early Chera ruler, Cheramon Perun Chotru Udiyanjeral, verse number 2 of the Purananuru collection. The poet is mentioned as Moranjiyur Mudinagaraya. This is an exact reflection of what is mentioned in Manu's Dharma Shastra about the Brahmanas performing Vedic rituals in Tamil Nadu. Next. The poem, there are two more. Manu says, where it freely moves, the black buck freely moves without any fear. And there, these are additional portrayals of the deer moving. Next. This is that great panel at Mahabalipuram, 700 AD. And look at what is falling from the top is the Ganga. And on the right side, you have Shiva giving Pashupatastra. And then you have wonderful depiction of elephants bringing firewood for the Brahmanas to perform Vedic sacrifices. And then here you have the lower down, we have come down, and there you have a temple, and beneath I'll show you close up of this. So this represents the descent of the Ganges coming from the Himalayas, coming down, and we have a reference that river Kaveri, Ponni, is considered as sacred as Ganga. It is always connected with the Ganga. Gangair Punidamaya Kaveri. We have medieval poetry. What do you want? Time. Time. Don't worry. Next. Yes, I come back because I focus on this. Manu's this thing has been done. Next. Next. Now, in between the forest region, they move freely, the black bag. Next. There is a bag there. Here you have the bottom, the Brahmanas performing rituals. I am keeping a view on my watch, and hopefully, who said? I am aware of that. I have already told you that I keep my watch. Next one, please. Now here you have the Brahmanas performing Sandhya. Next one. You can see the Brahmana. Next. You have, there are some more other points. Next. You have a tiger. Tiger is generally ferocious, but here it is represented as a mother. You see a calf jumping up, sucking up milk. Next. Then here you have a false cat performing. But in our inscriptional literature, they say, Tandayilorukku Tandayahiyam Thayilorukku Thayahiyam. The king acts as the mother, affectionate mother, in ruling his own country. Here you have another this thing. It's very important. These are all the points mentioned in Manu. Right. In the Chola inscriptions, it's a specific mention that Manu's law has been established in that country. And it says, ஒன்றினோடு ஒன்றுக்கும் ஒருவரோடு ஒருவருக்கும் வெறு வறு பகைமை மனத்து இன்றி உடன் சேர காதலுடன். There should be no hatred in the minds between one and the other, one man and the other man, and also between the animals and all living beings. Here we have the cat and also the rat, side by side. Both are opponents. Next. Now, this is the mountain, Himalayan mountain, right? Okay, next. 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 I am going to show you another one. Do you see a cow? Do you standing? Go back. There is a, go back. See here, there is a torana, and beneath it there is a cow. And next, look at the cow, very angry, ferocious. Next, it is standing before a calf, its own calf, which was run over by Manu, who was the Chola ancestors of the Chola ruler. And that cow is asking for judgment. And this is very beautifully described in Tamil literature, that Manu was known for his great Nidhi, Manu Nidhi. Even now we have Manu Nidhi Chola. Next. Next. See, this is Manu himself. Accidentally, the calf jumped into the path of the prince, and it was run over by the prince, the crown prince, that is Manu's son. And so Manu punished him by putting him under the chariot and killing his own son, which he thought is the correct judgment that he has to deliver. And he must feel the same pangs of agony like the cow. And so that is portrayed in a great literature called Periya Puranam, and that is given a visual form in the Chola period itself. Next, you see here, you see this is a stone chariot and whom you have this Manu's son put in. So Manu was known for his judgment. The judiciary was basing all their conclusions on Manu's Dharma Shastra. What happened? It is not possible, sir. I cannot stop it before 30 minutes. Right? You can't ask me to stop. Just tell me 15 minutes and then close it up. Don't do that. Please. Go, next. 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 Now this is a monumental one to cow, which has been given the judgment by Manu himself. And that shows in Tamil Nadu, Manu Dharma Shastra was the ruling law book. And this has been given in the 12th century monumental. These are all the visual evidences to show that Manu's rule was established in Tamil Nadu. Next. Now I am showing you just one. Vada adu panipadu neduvarai, vadakkum tena adu thuruvelu therkkum, குணாது கரை பொருதுடு கடல் குணக்கும், முதிர் பவ்வத்தின் குடக்கும், முப்புணர் அடுக்கிய முழு முதற் கட்டில். The complete geographical boundary of the country, beginning from Himalaya to Kumari, is mentioned in this Tamil poem, which is also 2000 year old one. This is what is required. In your literary festival, you must know that Tamil literature does not portray an individual culture, but it is an integrated culture. This is a complete Pani Padu Nadivare. Pani Madai means Himalayas. Kumari. Next. The poem sung by, this is by Kari Kidar, Palyaga Sale Mudugudimi Peruvedi. Look at that. He is a great king. He was performing several yagas. Pal Yaga Sale. Yaga Sala Mudugudimi Peruvedi. Next. And these are, I'm sorry, this has been disturbed. This is another very important concept of Manu, which is also referred to in the, what you call, early Sangam literature, where how Brahmins were treated in Tamil Nadu as per Manu's. Next one. This is another poem. Next. Two things I want to tell you. when the British took over this country, colonial rule was established at approximately about 1780 or 1800. The British, they told us that we had no records, written records. They have written it in their own, district gazetteers. You have several district gazetteers. They say that we are bound to rule this country. Indians know nothing about tradition, ownership rights, judiciary. Everything was brought by us. And so they ignored all the documents that existed before them by way of Tamrasasanas, Shilasasanas, ownerships established by all these written documents as per our Dharma Shastra. And they appointed their own officers as collectors. Collectors of what? Collectors of revenue for the British people to take it away. And that is the system we follow even today. All these collectors and all these are all meant only for revenue connection. And here are, we have poems after poems after poems in Tamil referring to documentation, judiciary, administration, all this. I have examples one after the other because I was promised 30 minutes to speak and I am now only 20 minutes. I have exhausted and I think I better stop it now because my friends are getting... So only thing that I want to tell you is, this is not the only the administrative side. In the lifestyle, the last point which I want to mention, very importantly, the marriage custom of the Tamils are sung in many Tamil poems called Aharanuru. And the whole process of marriage is described, which is nothing but the Vedic marriage of the northern part of India. Some of these ideas are also forgotten here in the southern part. I am told in marriage that the boy goes and lifts the wheel of the bride, That is a custom which is referred to in 2,000-year-old Tamil literature here, which was prevalent in Tamil Nadu 2,000 years ago. And then all the rites were all directed by the Brahmins, Vedic Brahmanas. This is given there in 2,000-year-old literature. Marriage customs, the death rites, the birth rites, and so on, the entire personal life of the individual, and also the individual's life in the community as a member of the community under the king. These are all described in detail in 2000-year-old poetry. So both in personal life and in the social life, and also in the administration of justice and administration itself, these are all documented from Assam, Bihar, Bengal, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Andhra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, all ruled by the same law of Manu and Yajnavalkya and others. So there is, if there is any proof that you want, that there was only one culture in this country, you have to come to our study of inscriptions, sasanas, art, literature, and also documents that have been preserved to understand it. So thank you very much for giving me.
Thank you, sir, for that enlightening speech. Now I call upon Nagarajan sir. So he is a Dharma warrior associated with the Temple Worshipper Society, fighting for the rights of the Hindus to maintain our temples. So he will explain his work and how it fits in the overall cultural scheme of Tamil Nadu.
Namaste and good afternoon to all of you. It's going to be a very challenging effort to keep a lot of interesting audience awake, specifically after a very sumptuous lunch and an erudite presentation by most venerable Dr. Nagaswamy. And I just want to share some thoughts with you that occurred to me during the course of yesterday and today. The first thought was triggered by what Dr. Nagaswamy said. Why is this called Tamil culture and not culture in Tamil Nadu? That's the first one. And yesterday we had MRV. He has actually contributed significantly to our own social life. He has invented a concoction called whiskey with lassi. That's kind of very interesting concoction. And he referred to something called, yesterday when he was speaking about it, he said, it's a Hindu culture is what we should talk about. I want to go a step beyond. The culture we have in the country is actually a temple culture. The nation's culture evolved around temples. You take anything which is a contribution of a collective community, whether it be performing arts, music, murals, paintings, sculpture, architecture, on one hand, everything has evolved around temples. There is a lot of parallel between what we refer to as Carnatic music here and the music that prevails in the north as Hindustani music, which of course has had some influences from other overseas cultures. There are a lot of parallels. And the only reason why a lot of, if you for a moment just stop by for a second and think about what is the dance culture in north. We have Bharatnatyam and different variations of Kuchipudi and Odissi in South. What is it in North? Kathak? Kathak, did somebody say? Give me a break. Why is those cultures missing in North? It's missing in North because the temples are missing in North. Because the temples were destroyed, therefore the culture is missing. So coming back, temples were the fulcrum of our culture and it is uniform across the country. Now, why are we talking about, what is it that triggered us to think about Tamil culture and what Dr. Nagaswamy said, culture in Tamil Nadu? And I want to present to you a hypothesis. The hypothesis is this, the focus on Tamil culture exists today, and as we all have seen the recent elections, Tamil Nadu is the only state to elect four communists. 4 commies across the country, no, rejected in West Bengal, rejected in one guy in Kerala, 5. The reason is, in Tamil Nadu, we seem to have an anti-culture. The entire anchorings of the culture in Tamil Nadu is anti-national culture. And we need to understand where it came from. The anti-national culture emerged in 1920 when a bunch of buffoons, because they couldn't find favor with the British, and they thought that a specific community was being favored for their intellect, they started something called the self-respect movement in 1920. And the entire anchorings of the self-respect movement was nothing but anti-Brahmanism, anti-intellectualism, anti-national. And this self-respect movement gained to such an extent that within 30, 40 years, the stalwarts of that movement started talking about, Britishers, don't leave us, rule Tamil Nadu from London, let the entire country get freedom. That is, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, is the Dravidian discourse that emerged as the anti-cultural discourse in Tamil Nadu. This also was fueled, incidentally, around the same time, thanks to the legacy of Macaulay and Max Muller, who floated this theory called Aryans' invasion, which kind of played into the hands of these so-called self-respect. I don't know what kind of respect they were trying to preserve. Okay. And thanks to the Aryan invasion theory, the Britishers found an excellent wedge to divide this country. And I can't, for the life of me, imagine how a 5% population of Tamil Nadu Brahmins could be a target of persecution from 1920 onwards. And the Aryan invasion theory was an excellent tool for the British to classify the entire southern population as being a Dravidian population who have been conquered and driven to the south. Nothing could be further from truth, as Dr. Nagaswamy demonstrated. There's one Manush Dharma Shastra across the country. And today, you can see elements of our culture, which has existed for centuries, two millenniums, if you will, being appropriated selectively by the so-called Dravidian discourse. I want to refer to something called the New Year's. All of us know, nationally, we celebrate New Year's when the sun moves to a specific zodiac sign, Aries. We call it the New Year. Different way, moon, sun. And here was this guy called Karunanidhi who decided that Pongal will be the New Year in Tamil Nadu for the reason he thought that Pongal was a Tamil festival. God's sake, Baishakhi, same time. Punjabi guys, they celebrated. And this ticketless traveler, Goon from Tiruvarur, thought that Pongal was a Tamil festival, and he decided to change the New Year's from the time when sun enters Aries to Pongal when sun enters Capricorn. And guess what? The Tamilian people rejected it. And then this guy started off by claiming that Jallikattu was a Tamil festival. Guys, Jallikattu was celebration of the bull. Was a perfect way of evolving the bull genies to preserve the cattle. And the bulls were called the temple bulls. And they were bred to sustain agriculture and community. And the entire, and of course, in the morning we also referred to the Christian evangelism and the jihadi, Islamic jihadism, trying to, and this is exactly what's happening in Tamil Nadu, the Christian evangelism and jihadi communism, just give me a second, Jataayu here. And the Islamic jihadism rode on the Jallikattu bandwagon and tried to appropriate a Jallikattu, essentially a temple-sponsored festival, to be something anti-cultural and something to do with Tamil culture, which is one of the myths being propagated. So as much as we see threats from outside across different regions of the country, in Tamil Nadu, the threat is pure and simple Dravidism. And the good news is, it's slowly dying. And the way we can preserve it, and the way we can sustain our culture, is to preserve our temples. remember, the Justice Party came to power in 1925. I want you guys to understand this very clearly. In 1852, the British East Indian Company at that time returned the temples to the communities. They took over the temples in 1810 through the regulations, 1810 of Tamil Nadu, 1817 of Bengal. And they held it for some years, preserved the wealth, given back to community in 1852. 1925, the first Indian law to control temple endowment was passed by Dravidian government, resulted in 53, etc., etc. I will go into that, and we need some more time for that. So I just want to conclude that the Dravidian effort at dividing the people, destroying the culture, started with the appropriation and destruction and looting of temples. And that continues to manifest itself in the anti-national cultural discourse that is now popularly referred to as the Dravidian culture. Thank you for the patience. Those are the short words.
Thank you for that presentation, Nagarajan sir. Now I call upon Ganesh Lakshminarayanan to, you know, speak about his views on how the Indic idioms have been present in the Tamil culture, Tamil literature from the earliest times. So he will make his presentation.
Yeah. Thank you. Good afternoon. It's not lost on me that I'm the only guy speaking about Tamil literature and culture. I'm the one who's dressed up in a uniform which is not representing Tamil culture. And I wanted to make a point that what we confuse as culture are the behaviors and rituals and don't really understand, you know, what truly culture is. And I just want to reflect on a few points sir made. You know, I come from a corporate world. I spent 15 years in Dell. So when we talk about culture, we talk about corporate culture, right? So there's so much about corporate culture. And if you truly ask as a head honcho or a CEO, what is really culture? They won't say what uniforms you wear or the way you speak is culture. Culture has got three important aspects. One is there is a purpose to the culture. And there are beliefs which reinforces the purpose. And there are values which you live by, which reinforces the belief. So if you want to truly understand one culture is same as another culture, you want to go back to what was the true purpose of that culture and as exhibited by the literature written during that period. And there is no better literature to reflect Tamil culture than Sangam literature, because you could argue that it was pretty much not influenced by a lot of other things which came later. So if you go back to the Sangam literature and look at what was the true purpose of the Tamil culture, you will find exactly what sir said. Because Avayar said, the purpose of a Tamil life is eedal aram, thivinai vittu eetal purul, yengandrum kaadal iruvar karuthurimithu inbam kandadhe valkai, paranai ninaithayum moondrayum vittadhe veedu. So the four purusharthas which was mentioned, which is basically dharma, artha, kama and moksha, is the same purpose of life which Tamils lived under. So you can't say that Tamil culture or culture in Tamil Nadu is different if I can show that the purpose of that culture was no different than the culture which is exhibited in India, right? Then let's come to the beliefs of those people. They believed in God. Contrary to what you would hear, there is God mentioned in Sangam literature. There is mention of Thirumal in Sangam literature. You probably heard the story of, you know, Krishna taking away the clothes of Gopika and staying on the tree. There's actually an alternative nice version of that story where Krishna actually sits on the branch of the tree and pushes the branch down so that the girls can hide themselves and change their clothes. So contrary to what you think, there was mention of Krishna, there was mention of Shiva, there was mention of Muruga and these beliefs, and they believed in rebirth. So the beliefs as exhibited by the Tamil culture were no different than the beliefs which existed in the period. When it comes to values of that culture, the values of the cultures were very similar. So what were the values exhibited in the Tamil literature of the Sangam poems? It's literacy. It is your fear, you know, eco-friendliness. It's hospitality. It's equality. and openness to other culture. What you really find amazing about Tamil culture or people who lived in that period is they were working with people from all across India. They were working with people from outside of India and they were truly embracing this, right? And then you come to, you know, the rituals and behaviors, which as you think of as a culture, the rituals and behaviors may have changed. You know, IBM once wore a suit. Now today they don't wear a suit. But that doesn't take away the true purpose of what IBM stood as a company. So today I'm wearing this dress. It doesn't take away anything from the fact that I am truly a Tamilian in my culture. So the rituals could have changed. You know, if you look at today's marriages of Tamil, it doesn't look anything like the Tamil marriages are described because there is Sangeet, you know, only the bride and groom are the same. But there is first night. There is what sir said, lifting the veil. That's mentioned in the Tamil marriage which was celebrated in 300 BC. So my submission to you is, let's use this framework. A culture is reinforced by the purpose, the beliefs, and the values. As long as you find more similarity in these three aspects, you can describe a corporate as very similar to another corporate, and we can do an acquisition, we can merge very quickly. And that is what we should bring as an evaluation of culture. We should bring this framework objectively and show whether the culture in Tamil Nadu was any different than the culture of the rest of the country. And ladies and gentlemen, my answer is no, because you find so much commonality in the same three aspects of culture. Thank you.
Thanks for the very short punch-packed talk, Ganesh. So we have time for two, three quick questions. Yes. Yeah. Mike.
So my question is to Dr. Nagaswamy that recently Kidadi excavation has found Tamil Brahmi script, and they are using that as a weapon to describe it as a continuation of Indus Valley civilization, and the Aryans were came afterwards. So what is your view on the new Kidadi excavation on that?
There is no such a thing as Tamil Brahmi. There is only one Brahmi. Brahmi from Himalayas, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, and from Afghanistan to throughout India, and Thailand, Cambodia, Laos, and also Vietnam. In all the Southeast Asian countries, there was only one script that was introduced by Ashoka in 3rd century, and all the various scripts which we have here in India and also in Southeast Asia all evolved from only that particular one. It has nothing to do with the invasion of Aryan, Dravidian, and this is the discovery of Tamilian. These are all modern effort to say that I am greater than this man, and not based on any evidence. We want pramana, what we call actual evidence to prove any statement, and where there is no evidence, we reject it.
This is to you, Jataayu, sir. And do you think today's Tamil youths are failing this Hindu cause? Failing to, like, propagate?
On the culture front, the Tamil youth, regarding Tamil youth, a lot could be desired, right? So I won't say they are failing. I think that would be too much of a generalization of looking at, you know, some of the anti-Modi or anti-national, anti-Hindu social media meme and fire. I think that is still a very small fringe element of the Tamil youth. See, you go to any temples, it is brimming with Tamil youth, both male and female, right? So you go to cultural programs. They are heavily into culture. People are celebrating festivals. But I would think that there is a cultural misrepresentation that has been steadily going on in the Tamil media specifically, and by some Tamil political leaders and parties, that needs to be countered more effectively than what is currently being done. But I really don't think Tamil youth are failing India or their culture.
My question to Mr. Ganapathy, do you think, I am not from Tamil Nadu, but I've studied in Tamil Nadu. So do you think there is an atheist movement which is gathering pace in Tamil Nadu? Atheist movement which is gathering foundation here in Tamil Nadu?
You know, the founder and this and the, his disciple of the atheist movement, his wife and his family went to the temples. So I'm not really sure whether the atheist movement is gaining traction in Tamil Nadu. Because Tamil Nadu, I go back to the culture, the purpose of the Tamil Nadu culture or people who lived in Tamil Nadu, their belief was in God. And how can you come and say God doesn't exist just because 100 years ago and people suddenly say, yeah, I don't believe in God. That's not going to change. So I don't think there is an atheist movement in Tamil Nadu. If anything, the people who are visiting temples and who are praying to God, the percentage is actually increased. And interestingly, their own thinking now, or the people who want to make use of the atheist movement, is their own thinking is we are probably alienating the population by doing that. And they go to temples now. So I don't think there is any atheist movement in Tamil Nadu. I don't think we should worry about that.
So my question is to Mr. Nagarajan. So you said that the dance and other forms of culture are connected with the temple. But now, are the temple rituals and festivals today killing or developing this culture?
Hey, thanks, it's a good question. To answer your question in short brief, in spite of the neglect of the government of temples, our ancient expression of art forms are continuing to be encouraged by temples. It's emerging, definitely, it's not being killed at all. But the challenge we are facing is, and one of the misconceptions is prevalent among many of us is, temples are meant only for worship. That is not so. Temples were the center of community life. And the community life, it meant everything, including education. What has happened is the enormous wealth behind the temples has been more or less been looted, misused, appropriated. And therefore, the larger community preservation has not taken place. And hopefully, in the next few years, I just want to give one example. I don't know how many of you are aware that north of Tamil Nadu, and sir will probably help clarify that as well, there's a temple called Thiruvatriyur Temple. And the Thiruvatriyur Temple, even today, there stands a Vyakarna Vakyana Mandapam. And this was the center of a Vyakarana school which was run more than 800 years ago. And the school focused only on how to express yourself unambiguously. And the students, roughly about 300 students from all over Southeast Asia. And there was even a hospital attached to it. So, not just art form and music form, several other knowledge pursuits was encouraged and supported by temples, which we have lost. And hopefully our movement to retrieve the temples from government control and use the temple wealth as they were intended to be should help us retrieve our own culture. Thank you.
I think we have run out of time. With that, I bring the session to a close. So those who are interested, they can contact the speakers offline and they can get their questions clarified. Thank you. Thank you all for coming.